In this video, we'll break down one of the most common tools in UX research, the Likert scale. If you've ever taken a survey that asked for your opinion on a scale from strongly agree to strongly disagree, then you've encountered one of these scales. And before you ask, yes, it really is pronounced Likert. Let's start with the basics. A Likert scale measures people's attitudes, opinions, or perceptions by asking them to rate their level of agreement with statements. Developed in the 1930s by psychologist Rensis Likert, it has become a go-to method for gathering nuanced opinions. For example, imagine you're evaluating a website's ease of use. You might ask users to rate how much they agree with the statement, "This website is easy to navigate." Their responses will likely range from strongly agree to strongly disagree, capturing the degree of agreement. Each statement in the survey is called a Likert item. These items, when grouped together, provide a reliable measure of user satisfaction or sentiment. Likert scales are effective because they capture the degree of opinion, not just a binary yes or no. This is incredibly useful in UX research, where user experiences are often more nuanced. But like any tool, they aren't perfect. There are two key biases to watch out for when using Likert scales. First is acquiescence bias. This happens when respondents tend to agree with statements more often than they disagree, regardless of their true feelings. To combat this, you can alternate between positively and negatively worded statements. For example, take these questions from a famous UX Likert scale, the System Usability Scale. Question 1 is worded positively. I think I would like to use this system frequently. Question 2 is worded negatively. I found this system unnecessarily complex. The alternating of positive and negative statements, which is called reverse keyed statements, continues throughout the scale and helps counteract acquiescence bias. The other bias to watch out for is social desirability bias. Here, respondents answer in a way they believe will be viewed more favorably by others. A good way to reduce this bias is to ensure anonymity, encouraging more honest responses. When designing Likert scales, there are a few best practices to follow. Use clear and consistent labels. Stick with standard response options like strongly agree, agree, and so on. This ensures consistency across surveys and makes it easier for participants to understand. Keep it simple. Avoid overly complicated or double-barreled questions. For example, don't ask, "This website is easy to use and fast to load." Split it into two items instead. Finally, consider adding open-ended questions. While Likert scales give you structured data, adding an open text field can help uncover the why behind the ratings, offering richer insights into user opinions. Likert scales are a simple yet powerful way to measure users' attitudes and opinions. When used correctly, they can provide valuable insights into how users interact with your product or service. Remember to keep your questions clear, avoid common biases, and consider pairing them with open-ended responses for deeper insights.
Thanks for watching. If you want to see more of our UX videos, take a look at these over here and consider subscribing to our channel. On our website, nngroup.com, you can access a free library of over 2,000 articles. You can also register for one of our UX courses that offer live hands-on UX training.